You can then use a thing whenever, if you bear in mind you're uploading this massive big spreadsheet into Merchant Center, you can have these things called custom labels. And this is how you tell the feed what is your priority, what are your best sellers, what are your promotions, all that sort of thing. What it allows a company like us to do in AdWords is say, right, we can then segment without going through the whole feed. There might be 10,000 products. We don't have to go through and go, right, where's all the yellows? And we put a bid against that. We can pull all of those in automatically, put a bid against them, move on to the next one. It allows management of your feed and management of your campaigns to be a powerful amount easier. And it's much easier also to monitor and report if you have these things structured properly. So how you actually improve your feed? What makes stuff show on Google Shopping? Any ideas? Begins with R. Been talking about it all morning. There we go. You're not getting lollies for that one, because that was easy. You want to make sure that your feed is quality. So you want to make sure you're using clear, accurate, and up-to-date information. Your prices are right, your descriptions are right, all that sort of thing. You want to use high-quality images. You can't have your brand kind of, you know, watermarked across the middle of it or anything like that. It just has to be the product, nice and simple. You want to optimize your titles and descriptions. At the end of the day, say if somebody types in iPhone 6, give them an iPhone 6. Simple. They're not asking, you know, they're not reviewing different phones. They're not doing all that sort of stuff. They've asked for something in particular, so give it back to them. So in terms of your descriptions, if we just jump back a couple of pages, a good few pages, see up here, this is your title. So somebody in this scenario has typed in Ted Baker bag, Ted Baker, Ted Baker, Ted Baker, Ted Baker, Ted Baker. See, for me, that's not even a great search. Somebody looking for a Ted Baker bag doesn't know what they want yet. They don't know whether they want, this is where I now embarrass myself by knowing maybe too much or too little about handbags. They don't know whether they want this wee pink one, this big black one, this white one, a hold all, whatever it's gonna be. Would it not be better to wait, hold your money back, and appear when somebody types in Ted Baker cross hatch black handbag? Would that not be a better search to come up with? So all you're doing is giving the user back what they want in the first place in terms of their description. It's not, you know, it doesn't take a genius. Use promotional text. Within those ads, it can automatically say if there's a saving built in. You know, so if you have an RRP and a sale price, it will automatically show you what the saving is. Ultimately, if somebody's sitting there saying 30% off, it looks a powerful amount better than everybody else just sitting with the same price, especially if it's a branded product where a lot of the prices can be fixed. And then making sure that you have your product SKUs. So say, for example, we go back to the Ted Baker handbag. You might have Ted Baker handbag in small, medium, large, and extra large. So if somebody types in small Ted Baker handbag, they see the small one. They type in medium, they see the medium one. Why not give them exactly what they're looking for in the first place? Most people, from an SKU point of view, will put in Ted Baker bag. So somebody arrives in looking at the Ted Baker bag, and that is, to a degree, what they've asked for. But what if they're looking for the small one, and you're out of stock of it? They've arrived in with a genuine need for the small bag. They arrive through to your site, you've paid for the click, and it's not there. You've wasted your money, unless you can convince them to buy the medium or large one or whatever. So by using product SKUs, you can put in all variations, all different products. That fashion retailer that we work with, over Christmas, if you imagine, I jump back a few slides again, that Tommy Hilfiger main down coat, somebody typed that into Google, he was every single one of those. House of Fraser didn't come up, Debenhams didn't come up, John Lewis didn't come up. We had them coming up in every different color. If you typed in yellow, we had it all in different sizes. Whatever it was, we tried to fill every single criteria that people could have asked for. So again, looking at how we optimize our campaigns, make sure they're keyword rich and user friendly. Give people back what they want in the first place. In this scenario, if somebody types in red kettle, or sorry, somebody types in Morphe Richards 43904, this appears because they've asked for a Morphe Richards 43904. What you don't put in there is red kettle. You do have that in the description, but it's much further down. It's also in the title. It's also in the description, but it's pushed back a wee bit. The person that's going to buy that product is either looking for a red kettle, a Morphe Richards red kettle, a Morphe Richards 43904 kettle, something like that. And you get all that information from your own analytics or your own Google AdWords account, because it tells you exactly what people are actually typing in to find your product. So instead of trying to be smart and giving them back, you know, this is a Morphe Richards, I don't know, say it was a fancy color of red that nobody's ever heard of, and it does all these different things. If people aren't searching for it, they can't find it. Give them what they want in the first place and let the product convince them. Dead easy. Your descriptions themselves contain up to 5,000 characters, and basically the priority goes at the start. So in this scenario, again, I would describe this product as Morphe Richards Red Kettle. The description would be, First line, Morphy Richards Red Kettle. This red kettle from Morphy Richards contains 1.5 litres of water, 3 kilowatts, na 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 na. And as you get down the description, it becomes less relevant, essentially. So you pack it at the front with all your relevant information. Don't make it spammy. Don't kind of just repeat Morphy Richards Red Kettle, Morphy Richards Red Kettle. Google will crucify you for it. But try to make it keyword rich and user led. Simple as that. So this scenario here is just to give you an idea of how a simple search that we did for red mountain bike came up. So why is this one good and this one isn't? Bear in mind, we've looked for red mountain bike. Red mountain bike, this ad itself says red mountain bike, this one doesn't. So if somebody's looking for a red mountain bike, there's a better chance of them buying this one than there is of this one. It's a very, very simple example. Now, for me, I would actually have the description of this product as Scott Scale red mountain bike or Scott Scale 730-2015 mountain bike, solely because I actually Googled a red mountain bike about a month ago for my son, and we certainly didn't pay $2,000 for one. You know, so red mountain bike can be somebody wanting to spend 100 quid like I did, or it might be somebody wanting to spend $2,000. I would have that a lot more specific than that. But this one here, so we added in red mountain bike. They basically don't mention any of that. There is mountain in there. It is a bike. I suppose that's about as close as relevant as we have. Chances of that one getting clicked, a lot less than that one. Simple as that. So again, looking at optimization, you need to analyze what your user's actually doing. So learn what your shoppers are searching for and how they're searching. Do they do it on mobile? Do they spend, do they look at three different devices? Do they generally have to return to your website? Do they look at five different websites? You can use your search query report within AdWords to find out exactly what people have typed in. See, when you get back, look at that. Go to keywords, and then there's a button that says details, and then open that and it says all. Look at that and it will show you exactly what people have typed in. Normally, it's the first thing whenever we get an inquiry in and we get access to data accounts, the first thing we look at, and you'll generally save people 20, 30% of what they've actually paid so far. That's where we found out about that rotting bodies one. You're kind of sitting there going, don't do that, they don't do that, they don't do that, they don't do that. What you want to be doing with that in terms of shopping is telling Google you don't want to appear for all the stuff that's irrelevant. So say, for example, on the bikes, somebody type, that could appear for somebody typing in, I have no idea, trying to think of something very quickly. Blue bike. If it isn't a blue bike, tell Google it isn't. There's a system called negative keywords within AdWords where not only can you tell Google what you do want to appear for, but you tell them what you don't want to appear for. And in my opinion, it's as, if not more, important. So whenever you're doing your search term report, you'll see a big list of keywords that have triggered your ads. There's a box beside each one. The ones that you don't want, you can just tick the box, go to the top, and it says add as negative. You'll never appear for those key phrases again. It's also a great source of finding keywords that you do want to appear for that you maybe haven't thought of. So you want to make sure you add those irrelevant queries as negatives, and you want to monitor your conversions. Is it working for you? Are you actually selling stuff? You know, or are you just lining Google's pockets, which is not what we want to do? If it's not working, refine it. If it's still not working, you know what? Just stop. Not all of this stuff works. There are products on there that you just won't sell. You know, some people, if they're wanting to spend, what, $3,000 on a bike, they might want to pop in, sit on it, do all of that sort of stuff. You might just be flogging a dead horse, and your conversion data should show you that. I've harped on again how important mobile is. In 2014, online shopping on mobile overtook desktop. So we're now spending more time buying stuff on our mobiles than we are on desktop devices. This year is going to be a powerful amount worse. Every single market we're looking at the minute, desktop is going like that and mobile is going like that. It's actually a phenomenal rise, to be honest. You need to be looking at your shopping campaigns and adjusting your bids accordingly. If you consider that a third, as I said before, a third of purchases online started on mobile, it's important that you're there. Whether you can transact on mobile or not, it's still important that you're showing people or showing yourself to people whenever they try to find you in the first instance on mobile. So you need to consider, do I need to pay more to be up there on mobile to get found in the first place and then make sure that they come through for a lovely experience on the desktop device after that? So you need to make sure your mobile site experience is user-friendly, it's cleanly designed, the forms are nice and narrow, everything's done properly, and it's generally a responsive website. You can then do what is called the Google Mobile Friendly Test. This will tell you if your website is responsive, mobile-friendly. If it isn't, what you need to address. If anybody's brave enough, I can show you how that works if anybody wants their website tested on the device. But all you do is type in Google Mobile Friendly Test. Put in your URL and it'll tell you whether your site's up to scratch or not. As of the 21st of April, as I said earlier on, Google are going to be actively penalizing people whose sites aren't mobile friendly.